Good evening and welcome. It is now 7 o'clock, and the May 20th, 2014 meeting of the Duncanville City Council is now reconvened into open session. Our invocation tonight will be by Dr. Frank Alegria, pastor of First United Methodist Church, followed by our two pledges of allegiance. Would you please stand?
Almighty God, we give you thanks for another day of life. Those in positions of leadership.
Flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Under the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
I have several things to mention tonight for my mayor's report. The first kind of announcement is you may have noticed on your agenda that there was to be a reception tonight for Dr. Stephen Jones. That is going to have to be postponed because he is not able to stay tonight. He has some other commitments. So please note that that will be rescheduled in the future. Another kind of minor announcement is I've had some concerns about people seeing Kidsville shut down. Because we know it's getting up there in years, and no, it's not being torn down or replaced. It's just closed for maintenance, and the plans are to have it open in time for the holiday weekend starting Friday evening. Then I'll briefly mention again the Sweep It Out event this Saturday, where you can bring in your trash and junk and have it hauled away. We'll have paper shredders, and we'll also do some recycling. About the only thing you can't bring is hazardous chemicals. So I wanted to remind you that. I talked in more depth of that at the last meeting. And now the one thing I would like to mention is I had a telephone call from a lady, and she didn't give her name. There was no caller ID, so I really don't know how to contact her. But she spoke very kind and respectfully. But her concern was all of the political flyers that are being put on doors because she was out of town. And she felt that this was a sign to anybody in the neighborhood that the house was not being lived in or was vacant at the time. And I know that's a problem, but we do, as people running for office in multiple offices going on, even the county and everything, need a way to get information out to people. What I would suggest, though, is we have a Citizens on Patrol program, and all you have to do is email up here or stop by and you request a vacation check, and they will come by on a regular basis and watch your home when you're gone. You tell them when you're going to be gone. And I don't know if they're trained to look for things on the doors and that, but maybe we could have that included so that people can leave and feel that their houses are being watched by someone in authority that can take care of those issues for them. So just bear that in mind, that the Citizens on Patrol do offer that as a free service here. Our next agenda item is council member reports. Councilman Cooks.
Yeah, I'd like to take the opportunity to tell you how exciting it is to be in the city of Duncanville. Thinking about things that has happened over this year, reflecting, you know, the quality of life that we have in Duncanville, from our parks to our proposed bike opportunity in our city, from the walk and the runs that we've been having out throughout the year, from churches to the city. What a great time to live in Duncanville. And then the other part I guess I'm always excited about is any time that we can get a group of citizens and pastors and lay people praying over our city. I just want to encourage you that if you'll look up and check with a couple of local pastors of this city to see if they're a part of the local prayer committee, that they'll go around to different businesses, parks, and actually have about a 30 minutes or an hour prayer session throughout our city. So I want to encourage you that those three things, that the quality of life and all the things we have to walk the races in our city, to be a part of those items. And then the other part that I want to make a part of our report would be the flexibility of our city. I think as we have seen a lot of things happen over the years, over the last 2 years or so for me, we need to kind of think about, you know, is it time now to look up and see, can we assign a charter review committee? I think that is something that our city needs to look at. You know, I think the last time, and I could be incorrect on the date, but the last time that a review of our charter was 1991 or 2005. But I think either one of those dates, we need to look and say, how do we come up with a charter review committee? If that's something that interested you, I would tell you to get with your local council person and see how you can make that happen. Now, it won't be the same, or it will be the same, if you have the same people on that charter review committee. And so I would encourage you to get more people involved into our city. I would encourage you that if you've not participated in a board or your voice, other than the 2 minute or 3 minute comment period, to get involved into our city period. Because we definitely need not only a charter review committee, we also need someone to come up with saying, here's the vision of Duncanville, and is this vision still a live vision, or we need to do it, or should it be adjusted? You know, your city council representative can easily do that for us, but I don't think it's left up to the city council person. I think it's left up to each one of us in this room, each one of us that's reviewing this broadcast, to be a part of our city to make it worthwhile for us. For instance, we look at our sign committee, we look at all of the things that's required, our parks, all the things that may be outdated a little bit to me. And I think if we get more people involved who will speak up and be a part of the process, we will continue to have a great city that we currently have. So I just want to leave those things with you as a part of my councilman report tonight. Thank you.
Councilman Boyd.
I just want to compliment again the Parks Group and your handling of the Saturday events that we had. Nothing but positive events coming from people. But there was a real special group that weren't able to speak, but they barked a lot. We had a bark in the park, and I tell you, it was, as Bart told me, they had to extend it time frame wise. There were so many people bringing their animals for the veterinarian, the vaccination, but it was really fun. And then with the Duncan Switch, there was even one vendor who was selling dog clothes. I mean, she was thankful and she planned properly, and probably most of the dogs walked on down to the Duncan Switch activities. But it was just a fun community day, and I know that doesn't happen without a lot of hard work by everybody, including our police department, our street department, and the parks people. And I just want to say thank y'all for what you do.
Councilwoman Jameson.
I wanted to take this opportunity. This is Dr. Jones, Dr. Stephen Jones's last night. Say that he's one of the finest individuals I've ever known. and I've enjoyed serving with him and his leadership. He's quiet, insightful, thoughtful, and I heard comments from people saying, he doesn't talk a lot, he doesn't talk a lot. No, some of us should talk less. And when he does speak, it's powerful. He has a powerful message, and he's gracious, kind. He's really added a lot to the council in the 2 years he's been here. And we're the ones that will be at a loss without him. I do not know Mr. Rutherford. I look forward to working with him. But I did want to say something and not have Dr. Jones just sail peacefully into the night and we didn't recognize what a fine individual he is and how much he has added to the conversation. We've had many conversations behind closed doors that you're not aware of, or you're not a part of. Maybe you're aware of them, but you're not there. And he always adds to that conversation, and you would be proud of the things that he says and does, the projects he's working on. He is an interim dean in Mountain View, and he also pastors a church. And I know Mountain View would like for him to be more than just a dean, but he has let them know that the church comes first. So I will miss him. And once again, congratulations to Mr. Rutherford, and on we go.
Councilman Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to kind of piggyback on what Councilman Boyd said. A big thank you to the city staff for their handling of the Duncan switch Saturday on Main Street. Everything from our public works folks that were put out the barricades to the police officers to everybody involved in it. Within an hour after the event being completed that day, every single thing was gone. You couldn't even tell anything had happened on Main Street. And kudos to those guys for a great job and a great event for the city of Duncanville.
That's all the lights I have. Next on our agenda will be two proclamations. The first one for National Public Works Week, and the second one for May is Lupus Awareness Month. Well, here tonight is Mr. Ragsdale from our Public Works Department, and he's here to accept the proclamation. Whereas public works infrastructure, facilities, and services are an integral part of our citizens' everyday lives and of vital importance to sustainable communities and the health, safety, and well-being of the people of Duncanville, and whereas such facilities and services could not be provided without the dedicated efforts of public works professionals, engineers, managers, and employees from your local public works department who are responsible for and who plan, design, build, operate, and maintain the transportation, water supply, water treatment, public buildings, structures, and facilities, and who deliver solid waste services, transit, and fleet services, which are essential to serve our citizens, and whereas the efficiency of the qualified and dedicated personnel who staff our public works department is materially influenced by the people's attitude and understanding of the importance of the work they perform, and whereas the men and women of the Public Works Department of the City of Duncanville unceasingly provide a vital public service. Now, therefore, I, Deborah Hodge, Mayor of the City of Duncanville, Texas, do hereby call upon all citizens of Duncanville and upon all patriotic, civic, and educational organizations to observe the week of May 18th to 24th, 2014 as National Public Works Week, with appropriate ceremonies and observances in which all of our people may join commemorating Public Works Department employees of the City of Duncanville, past and present, who, by their faithful and loyal devotion to their responsibilities, have rendered a dedicated service to our community, and in so doing have established for themselves an enviable and enduring reputation for preserving the health, safety, and well-being of all citizens. Thank you.
Mayor, thank you so much on the behalf of the 53 employees in our department. Let me just introduce a couple people in our staff. Mike Brownlee, the assistant director, and Claire Codwell, our executive assistant. And let me just kind of briefly give you a little insight as to what Public Works does. Our streets department maintains 153 miles of street. Our traffic department maintains 36 traffic signals and 10,800 traffic signs. Our drainage department maintains all the creeks and erosion. Fleet maintains 119 vehicles and 56 pieces of equipment, such as the backhoes. In the water department, we have 190 miles of water line to maintain. Wastewater, 154 miles of wastewater lines. In solid waste, we have 11,315 homes to pick up trash service for. We have building inspection, code enforcement, engineering, and planning to look over the 7,200 acres in our city. So to all the staff, thank you very much.
Angela Johnson?
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
You. Whereas each year the Lupus Foundation of America designates May as National Lupus Awareness Month to show support for the estimated 1.5 million Americans who have lupus, and whereas lupus is an unpredictable and misunderstood autoimmune disease that ravages different parts of the body. It is difficult to diagnose, hard to live with, and a challenge to treat, and whereas lupus can affect any part of the body, including the skin, lungs, heart, kidneys, and brain. No organ is spared. The disease can cause seizures, strokes, heart attacks, miscarriages, and organ failure. And whereas, lupus can be particularly difficult to diagnose because its symptoms are similar to those of many other illnesses, and major gaps exist in understanding the causes and consequences of lupus. More than half of all people with lupus take 4 or more years and visit 3 or more doctors before obtaining a correct diagnosis. And whereas lupus strikes most women of childbearing age, no one is safe from lupus. African Americans, Hispanics, Latinos, Asians, and Native Americans are 2 to 3 times more likely to develop lupus, a disparity that remains unexplained. And whereas 120,000 citizens diagnosed in Texas are affected by lupus. Now, therefore, I, Deborah Hodge, Mayor of the City of Duncanville, Texas, do hereby proclaim May 14th as Lupus Awareness Month in the City of Duncanville, and urge all citizens to join me and the Lone Star Chapter of the Lupus Foundation of America in supporting programs of research, education, and community service by educating ourselves on the symptoms and impact of lupus.
Hello, everyone. My name is Angela Johnson, and I am the treasurer of the Lupus Foundation of North Texas Lone Star Chapter. And I just want to thank you, Mayor Hodge, and the city council members, and also the citizens of the city here. Thank you guys so much for acknowledging May as Lupus Awareness Month. I am a lupus patient myself. I've had it going on 18 years now. And if you just look at me, it looks like I'm normal, that nothing is wrong, but if you do blood work for me or you look at my organs, then you can tell with tests that something is wrong. And there are lots of people walking around with symptoms, so it's very important for us as an organization, the Lupus Foundation of America, to get awareness out there, you know, just like AIDS or just like cancer. So if you know someone or if you know someone that knows someone, spread the word around. We do have a facility here in North Dallas area in Addison where you can get education. We have support groups if you have a hard time trying to get medication. You know, if you just need to talk to somebody, whether you're grieving, any questions, please give us a call. I have some information for the council members that I will leave. And if you want to go online and check us out, we're at www.lonestarlupus.org. And so thank you very much for your time today. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Agenda item 8P, receive a report on the Best Southwest Juneteenth celebration.
Was blind, but now I see. Get ready for an evening of gospel, R&B, education, and entertainment at the 2014 Juneteenth celebration.
Sing, Mark.
Wow. You know, when I called Lorraine this morning to ask her to do that, I didn't think that through very well. That's not something I really want to follow. Wow. Well, Lorraine is right. The time is near. Juneteenth is coming upon us on June 14th. We're very excited. I'm here to talk to you about tonight about what we have planned and hopefully get everyone excited. Obviously, Juneteenth is celebrated by our four sister cities, the Best Southwest Juneteenth, Cedar Hill, DeSoto, Duncanville, and Lancaster. The planning has been going on for quite some time. We've started at a Parks and Recreation Department level 6 months ago, just about, in January, 5 months ago, meeting with on a regular basis, kind of talking at a high level. Most of our staff are new to this event. It's new for us, especially to be here in Duncanville. No one was here 4 years ago when it was here. So we had a lot to learn. We also have an internal city committee that includes every department, because quite honestly, every department is involved with this event. It takes all of us to make it happen and to make it successful. Some of the planning efforts that have been going on, the more important planning aspects I want to make sure that you're aware of, are our transportation, parking, first aid, and safety. We're going to make sure folks can find us. There'll be wayfinding signs at all of our entryway points. Once you get to the parking areas, there'll be parking signs everywhere. There will be people on site to help you park. We will have a first aid station with our CERT folks. We have a lost aid station at our police station. And safety is of the utmost importance in this event. So we are working hard on that. One of the most important aspects of ensuring a successful event is having good marketing. So I wanted to highlight a few of the things we've been doing. The posters, banners, and flyers. You may have noticed that the new banner out here at Main and Wheatland that went up today. There's also another one at 67 in Main. There will be an additional banner that will be hung above Cedar Ridge Road over by the high school. Flyers went home to every elementary school and intermediate school student in all four cities. It's included in our water bill insert. We have radio advertising with KNON and K104. It's in Dallas Morning News, Guide Live. We have stuff on every local TV station website. There'll be ads running the Focus Daily News, yard signs, We've reached out to all the churches, including all of our quote-unquote mega churches here locally. We've also spoken with our Chamber of Commerce. Today, I reached out to the Greater Southwest Black Chamber of Commerce. I hope to get those folks involved. Of course, on all four city websites, and the thing we all do today is social media. So we're hitting it everything, hitting it all. Now, what's going to be going on? Well, one of the nice things that, and one of the reasons that Lorraine is involved with the Multicultural Commission is we're starting an education aspect of this this event. And they are doing a great project called Pathway to Freedom. They're going to illustrate the history and meaning of Juneteenth. They're going to have signage, informational signage, posted along the pathway around Armstrong Park. That's going to be really, really neat. Kids' activities, water slides, obstacle courses, rock climbing walls, face painting, balloon twisters, Kidsville Park, and something we just recently added was the ultimate game party truck. So we'll have video games for the youngins. Vendors, we're always looking for more vendors, so it's not too late. If there's anyone in the audience who would like to be a food vendor or a merchandise vendor, please come see me afterwards. It's also one of the reasons we're reaching out to the Chamber of Commerce is because we still need folks to come and provide services to the event. We have, I think, 8 vendors so far for food and several merchandise vendors lined up already, always looking for more. Live music and performers. Our MC will be Starlene Stringer. She is Duncanville native. She is a current KLTY radio host, and she is a former Miss Duncanville. So we're happy to have her come be our MC. The Star Spangled Banner will be sung by Lorraine Jack. And the Black National Anthem by Nikki Everett. And she'll follow into her set, followed by Olivia Blaylock, Kendra Lynn Cooks, our local Texas Dance and Cheer group out of the Rec Center, Camille Lachelle, and Neiman Ray. So.
I was clapping for Kendra Lynn Cooks, I'm sorry.
These are all local folks who come with great accolades, so we're looking forward to great things from these folks. And they will be in front of our headliner, which is Memphis Soul Review. A little bit for you. If you want to see the entire video, you can go to YouTube, put in Memphis Soul Review, and you'll see that entire video. It's about 10 minutes long. Quite honestly, they had me at hello, because the bird is one of my favorite songs of all time. So maybe I was a little prejudiced, but they're good. So what can you do? You can help spread the word about Juneteenth. We're all marketing experts when it comes to this event. So I have lots of posters here for you to take back with you. Anybody in the audience would like to have one to put in your place of business, please come see me. I've got some for the council as well. But it takes all of us to get the word out. So spread the word to all your friends, family, and neighbors to come on out. It'll be a truly great event for all ages. Really encourage the council to come out. Because it is here in Duncanville, we will be following the protocol that's been set forth before us. The mayor will be leading reading the proclamation, which will be at your next meeting. And she will also be able to introduce to each of you to the audience. So please come out and be recognized and come enjoy the fun. So, any questions?
Mayor Pro Tem Cooks.
Of course, you know I'm gonna have one. Bart, thank you and the entire group for putting this together for us. I know a lot of hard work is making this plan come together. I'm excited about this. I'm also excited not just because it's Juneteenth, but I'm excited that it's in the city of Duncanville. And so before I give questions to you, Bart, I want to encourage you, you know, this is not an African-American event. This is not an Hispanic event. This is a Duncanville event. And so if you have never participated in an event like this, let me encourage you to come out. I will tell you, you may be, if you're fearful for anything, Bart talked about the public safety piece. There's nothing to be fearful of at all. No. But if it's no more than to come out to be educated of what's going on at a Juneteenth event, I'm going to encourage you to do that. Bart, I noticed we started from 5 to 9. I want to know if there's anything perhaps that we have set aside for the seniors. Perhaps Cliff want to come a little early. I mean, I'm always picking up Cliff. Perhaps somebody want to come a little early from like 4 to 4:30 that they can perhaps beat the crowd. I want to know what can we offer for the seniors a little bit earlier than we could before 5 o'clock. Anything?
No.
There are no specific events. If they're, I might put them to work. I'm sure there will be activities going on. We'll have the bounce houses and stuff up at that point. I'm sure the seniors won't want to do that. But obviously we have the walking trail. There. I mean, it's a nice, beautiful park. They can partake of the natural beauty of the park and hopefully get a good seat, because I think it'll be a well-attended event.
And I know you put a lot of work into it. If it's even more so, if I would just encourage you to perhaps find something that our seniors could do from 4 to 4:30, even if it's that, I think for the first time I witnessed the game truck.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it's something like the game truck that the seniors can come and do, and something where, because this is a community event, and I really want to know this is near and dear to my heart because it's in Duncanville, and I know that we had it. The mayor and I and Cliff participated in the one in Lancaster last year, and when I knew it was going to be our turn as Duncanville to host it, I wanted to make sure I kept my antennas up.
Mm-hmm.
Because this represents all of us and not just one segment of Duncanville. We are a very balanced city, and this is a great way to show how balanced we are by full participation. So I would encourage you to find,
sure,
if you can find anything from, if it's a different timeline from 4 to 4:30 or 4:30 to 5, before everybody sort of getting here, that we can offer our seniors, that would really be great. I know our entertainment starts a little bit later, even if the entertainment caters to a little bit about for our seniors. Tell me, you mentioned church. You have church people coming. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about that part as well.
Well, we reached out to the churches to help with marketing, to include our information on their bulletins. A lot of the bigger churches have information up on the video boards before their services. So we've reached out to those folks to help us spread the word about Juneteenth here in Duncanville. Hopefully they'll do that. We've also asked if they wanted to participate. They wanted to have a booth, help with kids' events. We've made that offer as well.
Have you limited this only to the African-American churches, or have you reached across?
No, we're reaching out to all the churches.
To all the churches. Mm-hmm. And so if you're not getting any feedback from them, are you picking up the phone and giving them the call to encourage them?
We will
them
be. Absolutely.
Great. The other question I had was probably about the how will a Duncanville resident, or how will staff stand out that they represent Duncanville during this time? Is there any special attire that
we will have shirts that show that we are staff, correct?
Okay, correct.
Yeah, so if they have any questions, we'll have an information booth as well, and we'll have shirts that identify us as staff, so that if anybody has any questions, they'll know who to find.
Yeah. What about we've heard a lot about the Duncan Switch. Are they participating in this in any way to be there? I know normally they do it early in the day. have they agreed to perhaps be a part of having Dunkin' Switch there? I notice you only have 8 vendors, and I think we need way more than 8 vendors to be there. So what's our
effort? I'm confident that we will have way more by the time it gets here. Vendors are typically or historically very slow in coming in, and that we know that from our 4th of July. So I don't anticipate there being an issue with having the number of vendors there, but I would open that up to open that door up to anyone who wants to come out and encourage them to come early, because I do think it will fill up eventually.
Great, thanks. And you talked about the participation from all cities. Can you tell us a little bit about the history of the one from Lancaster and anything that stood out for that particular one?
Every event has a few staff members from each city come participate. We had, I think, 4 or 5 of our staff participate at the Lancaster event last year. I attended. It was a well-run event. I learned a lot. So probably the biggest takeaway from us helping out with those events is that we get to learn when it's our turn to host the event on what to do. So because of that, I think this will be a better event because our folks participated last year. With parking, with entertainment. So we helped in all those areas that we are now doing ourselves. So it was a great learning experience for us to move to this year.
All right, a couple of things, and I'll leave it. One, you talked about the educational piece of Juneteenth. Mm-hmm. What educational pieces will you be sharing with the general, with the community?
Well, that is something that the Multicultural Commission is working on, and I'd be happy to bring them up and talk about that. Lorraine, will you want to talk about that?
No. Well, I mean, you don't have to do it all now. I'm just kind of curious, but you all work in education.
Can she sing it?
That's something she will be singing, yes.
And for those of
But they are working on that, yes.
You know, I Googled this really quick, so I don't have the entire message, but it says, Juneteenth is a holiday that's celebrated in 37 of the 50 U.S. states. It's celebrated on June 19th and commemorates the abolishment of slavery. It began late in the 19th century amongst Afro-American population. So for those that wonder why we celebrate that, for sure. Bart, I want to thank you and your group in advance for the hard work that you're going to continue to put in this. And anything personally that I can do to help, please feel free to reach out to me. I know I do want to ask about any corporate sponsors. I know I've personally been challenging myself to reach out to corporate sponsors. And I'm not going to stop that until we find a couple of corporate sponsors.
Okay,
so can you, any information about corporate sponsors opportunities?
Their opportunities are there. We have not had any to date. We did reach out in the very beginning to our local community, our business community. But at this point in time, we have not had any takers for corporate sponsorships.
And will the city have any booths set up for citizens who come by and want to kind of sign up for volunteer opportunities?
Oh, absolutely.
We'll have booths set up for that?
Oh, absolutely.
All right, great. That's all my questions. Thank you, Bart, again. Okay. Appreciate that.
Councilman Boyd.
I'm leaving now.
Well, I have one idea. What you might do for us is you may get and puree them chicken legs. Okay? You know, maybe them turkey legs. I can't hardly eat those, and I love them. Maybe that vendor has turkey leg. You can get him to puree so we can eat from 4:30 to 5. But I do tell you the one vendor that would probably be very appropriate, and that would be one that has a hair-growing chemical. That might help some of the younger folks that don't have a full head of hair. Have a positive thing to say to you about. One of the things that I think would be good as you monitor your food vendors, because I'm telling you, this activity at the Dunkin' Switch, there were 4 or 5 this time. People love to eat on the street, and I don't know why, because I love it. I eat at every one of them. But you might want to consider having some food trucks on backup.
We have some.
Okay, but even more. I mean, look at your variety of food. And have the one food truck or two food trucks. When we have our teeth out, we can't speak good. but that might be a good thing to do, because that's one of the things they're considering. But the vendors are picking up with the crowd. So, but with this large crowd, I think if you can compliment your signed up people, even if you have to pay a little premium or guarantee them a minimum or something, just so that we have plenty of food. because a festivity like this needs to have plenty of food.
Agreed.
Okay.
And I'm sorry, Mayor, I do want to ask about public safety. You have it there. Tell us a little bit more about the public, the safety of the, during the event.
Sure. We will have our mobile command unit on site. Our CERT folks will be there for first aid. We will have 30 officers on site. We will have a multitude of our citizens on patrol, again, our CERT. So we will be well-staffed when it comes to safety.
Great.
Well-staffed.
All right. Thank you.
All right. That's all the lights I have. Thank you, Bart. Agenda 9P, receive the City of Duncanville financial report as of March 2014.
Good evening. My name is Richard Summerlin, Finance Director, and we will probably not have as much fun with this item as we just did because I don't have anybody to sing and you don't want to hear me sing. So let's hop into this. I decided that we would talk from graphs a little bit this time instead of talking from the numbers to give you a 30,000-foot view, if you will. When we look at our general fund revenues, what we've done is, in the blue column, we've taken our full adopted budget for the entire year. In the red column, that represents where we should be at this point, which is 50% halfway through the year. And then the green column represents our actual revenues, where we're at right now. This is not surprising that those general fund revenues are higher than 50% of the budget because they're primarily made up of property taxes, which we've talked about before. Those generally come in very early in the year. So we anticipate that, or we don't anticipate that there's anything unusual there. Let's look a little bit more closely at the breakdown. Again, on the left, you see the total property taxes that I just spoke about. So they're very near full collection. In fact, we've collected about 96.5% to date of those property taxes, or as of March 30th, rather. Our total sales tax, we're running a little bit ahead of where we would have those at 50%. Except that that's really not 50%. We're 2 months behind, so that really represents 33.3% since we only have actually, instead of 6 months, 4 months that are included there. And let's talk a little bit about sales tax. We did an analysis that I was able to share with the Economic Development Corporation Board. We took the first 4 months of the year and we analyzed those for 2014 versus the first 4 months of 2013. And we found something very interesting. Our construction-related industries are what is driving our increase in sales tax here in the city of Duncanville. And so my assistant finance director went a step further and reached out and contacted several of these businesses and talked to them about what it was that was driving this and, you know, what they were anticipating for the next several months. And they all reported that they were ecstatic with the growth that they've seen in their respective industries regarding their support of the home building industry. And so they also don't anticipate that there's any slowdown in that. They anticipate over the next several months for that increase to continue. So I say that in constructing a picture that right now our sales tax is very healthy and it's very much driven by the increase in the construction industry. And based on the feedback that we've got, we don't see that slowing down for a period of time. So I wanted to share that with you. Let's talk about franchise taxes. Again, those only represent about a quarter because they're so far behind, and so we're right on target. Our licenses and permits are on target. Total fines and fees are just slightly below on target. Our intergovernmental revenues are hardly even a blimp on the map. Interest revenue is so flat you can't really see it there because, as you well know, there's very little yield in the market right now. Our recreation fees are right on target. And then our total other sales and services, and operating transfers are very much on target. Let's look at the general fund expenditures. When we look at our total government, we're just slightly above where we ought to be on the green column versus the red column. We look at our total finance department, we're a little bit less than 50% of our yearly expenditures. Total community services, again, a fair amount below. The police department's running a little bit below budget on expenditures. Public Works is a little bit below, and the fire department's a little bit low. Non-departmental is a little bit slightly above where we should be, and then our transfers out, which I really need to make an adjustment because that's one of the things I need to fix on this report, because that really represents the amount that the general fund loaned to the Economic Development Corporation, and it's really a balance sheet item. Let's look at utility fund revenues. Not a pretty picture. We've took the amount of volume that we've pumped in water for the first 6 months, and we've looked at that, and February is the only month this year that was higher than it was last year. All the other months were less. We know this to be a trend because we had such a cold winter, so people typically did not use very much water. So our water revenues are quite a bit less than the 50% of where they should be. Sewer revenues are not quite as bad, but they're still definitely down, and of course, you know, they're tied into the amount of water that we pump. Our penalties are just slightly above where they were, where they should be, and our total other revenues are right about where they should be. If we look at our utility fund revenues and expenditures side by side, gives you another graphical analysis of that our revenues are a good bit below where they should be, and our expenditures are just slightly below where they should be. If we look at our economic development fund, this is a stratification of revenues and expenditures. So we have a little bit of interest, and we have some proceeds from general fund loan. And then we have our expenditures for the economic development. You can see those are a little bit above 50% of where they should be for this point in time. Keep Duncanville Beautiful is a little bit less than where they should be. Marketing's a little bit less. And debt service, unfortunately, our debt service is stratified into two payments a year. And the first one on economic development takes a principal payment. So we pay almost everything in that first payment in January, and so we make an interest-only payment at the end, so that's why that's skewed out. Economic development projects incentives, they're well above where we should be in terms of expenditures. Our quality of life projects are a little bit below, and then our other financing uses or transfers are a little bit below. I'll back up to the 4B sales tax. It's another adjustment, and I'm sorry, we're trying to do this. When you do something for the first run, you've got some adjustments to make, and I didn't adjust for the 50% to scale it back to 33 1/3, which is where it should be on sales tax. So really, if you bring that line down, you would see, if you brought the red line down to where it's supposed to be, the green line would actually be above that, because we are running ahead on sales tax. So I need to get that corrected. Again, if you look at our revenues beside expenditures, we're if we made the adjustment in sales tax, you'd see those revenues are above where they should be. Expenditures are also a little bit above where they should be at this point in time. If we look at our solid waste fund, again, this is a graphical depiction of where we're at with our revenues. They're a little bit less than 50%, which is our benchmark. Our expenditures have mirrored that, so they're not as much. Our other financing uses and our other expenditures, our total expenditures rather, are also below. If we look at our transportation improvement and safety fund revenue, I'm sorry, these kind of another one of the adjustments I need to make. They kind of ran over one another, so we need to make some adjustments on the graph. But the traffic enforcement fees are the first group of columns, and you can see that we're well above where we should be. And then our traffic fines are in the middle there, and there's not anything that we budgeted necessarily. This is basically our scoff law stuff. And then our interest is so low. And I'm sorry, it's very difficult when you have big, huge numbers to compare to real small numbers and make it show up on a graph like this without peeling stuff out separate. And so we may work on that so that you can actually see what interest on a smaller scale looks like. But it's almost a non-factor here. And then we look at our total revenues for transportation. It's well above where we should be. Our expenditures, traffic administration expenditures, a little bit less than half. Our scoff law administrative fees, again, was an item that we did not budget for. And so they're a blip on the map. Our amount that we paid the state of Texas, that's not showing up at all in actual because we don't pay that until the end of the year. And then our traffic street signal maintenance is right a little bit above where we should be for 50% of the year, but typically they do spend most of their money at the beginning of the year, and then our transfers out are right on target. If we look at our comprehensive self-insurance fund, again, our contributions going into that fund are right where they should be because that's something that we control. Our utility contributions are, again, right where they need to be, and the other fund contributions. Interest doesn't even really show up here. If we look at our expenditures, our insurance premiums, a good bit above where they should be. Our workers' comp claims are very much down. The insurance premiums are the revenues, and the workers' comp claims, they're about half of where we budgeted or where we should be for 50%. So the liability claims. So we're looking good there. If we look at the medical self-insurance fund revenues, again, the premiums are running just a little bit ahead of where we budgeted for. Nothing else to talk about there. The good story right now is that our medical claims are the biggest component of the medical self-insurance, and they're very much running below our 50% budgeted target. Our prescription claims are a little bit up, but that's actually a good thing. That means that folks are using the insurance plan, they're buying the prescriptions they need, and they're driving that medical claim cost down. So we're really actually happy to see that. And then our administrative expenses are a little bit less. And that concludes my report. Does anyone have any questions?
I have no lights. You must have done a good job. Thank you.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Agenda item 10P will be pulled from tonight's agenda. The Bryce family had an emergency and won't be here, and so we're going to combine this report with their June report at the second meeting in June. Agenda item 11 is a citizen's input. At this time, comments will be taken from the audience on any topic. To address the council, please submit a fully completed request card to the interim city secretary prior to the beginning of the citizen's input portion of the council meeting. In accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, the city council cannot discuss issues raised or make any decisions at this time. Issues may be referred to city staff for research and possible future action. When called forward, please state your name and address for the record and limit your comments to 2 minutes. First speaker will be Dr. Craig Thomas. Oh, yes, thank you. We'll wait for we are in a runoff season, so please turn off the video. All right, next we have our consent agenda items. Consider 12C, consider approval of the minutes from the May 6, 2014 regular council meeting as amended. 13C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, approving the canvass of returns and declaration of results of general election of municipal officers held on May 10th, 2014. 14C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, authorizing a joint election agreement and election services contract between the City of Duncanville, Dallas County, and various other jurisdictions within Dallas, Collin, and Denton counties for the conduct of a joint runoff election to be held on Saturday, June 21st, 2014, not to exceed $7,000, financing current funds. 15C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, awarding the Keep Duncanville Beautiful June 2014 Property of the Month to the W&B Service Company located at 1200 North Main Street and providing for an effective date. 16C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, denying the rate increase requested by Atmos Energy Corp. Mid-Tex Division under the company's 2014th annual rate review mechanism filing in all cities exercising original jurisdiction, requiring the company to reimburse cities reasonable rate-making expenses pertaining to review of the RRM, authorizing the city's participation with Atmos City Steering Committee in any appeal filed at the Railroad Commission of Texas by the company, requiring the company to reimburse cities reasonable rate-making expenses in any such appeal to the Railroad Commission, determining that this resolution was passed in accordance with the requirements of the Texas Open Meetings Act, adopting a savings clause and requiring delivery of this to the company and the steering committee's legal counsel. 17C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, to accept the sign control board decision to grant a sign variance for a pole sign located at 415 East Highway 67, Duncanville, Texas, for a legal, non-conforming highway sign at Henderson Orthodontics to construct, install, and maintain an additional 45 2/10 square feet LED sign to the existing pole sign. Same sign shall be located no closer than 2 feet from the right-of-way of US 67. The same shall not be located any closer than 5 feet from the southern property line on the property, as depicted in Exhibits A and A1, to grant variance allowing construction and maintenance of a wall sign of 93 square feet, as depicted in Exhibits B and B1, to grant a variance for the construction and maintenance of a monument sign on the right-of-way line at 415 East Highway 67, Duncanville, Texas, as depicted in Exhibit C and C1, and authorizing the interim city manager to execute the necessary documents. 18C, consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing the approval of a 16-month contract with TML Multi-State Intergovernmental Benefits Pool for Medical and Prescriptions Claims Administration and with ULLICO Fidelity Security for a 16-month contract for stop-loss insurance.
Move to approve.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Would you please vote? Motion carries 6-0. Agenda item 19, presentation for outgoing council member Dr. Stephen L. Jones. I have a plaque here for Dr. Stephen Jones in recognition of service to the City of Duncanville as Council Member, District 2, City of Duncanville, City Council, May 17th, 2012 to May 20th, 2014.
Thank you so much.
I briefly, too, would like to say some words, but I know you're running late, so I'll keep it very short. I want to thank you for the time that you put into this. I know you're a very busy individual, and it's been an honor to serve with you. It's been an honor to know you. You've enriched my life by just meeting you and being able to work with you.
Thank you.
And I want to ask God's blessings upon your future endeavors with your church and your ministry there and your work at the school, especially the extra time now you're going to have with your family. I'm sure they'll appreciate that.
They do.
But thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll keep this short because I do have to be across town in the next 10 minutes. It was indeed an honor to serve on this council with the mayor and the other council members, and it was also an honor to serve the citizens of District 2. I just want to thank you all for indulging me for these 2 years, and my prayers go out to Mr. Rutherford and the years that he will have here on the council. God bless you all.
Our next agenda item will be the swearing in of our new council member for District 2, Stephen Rutherford. Please come forward. And he's going to be having his wife swear him in this evening.
In the name and by the authority.
In the name and by the authority
of the state of Texas,
I, Stephen E. Rutherford,
do solemnly swear or affirm
that I will faithfully execute
the duties of the office of District 2 Duncanville City Council of the state of Texas and to the best of my ability
preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution and laws of the United States
and of this state, so help me God. Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome. We have a certificate here for him in the name and the authority of the state of Texas. This is to certify that at general election held on the 10th day of May, 2014, Stephen E. Rutherford was duly elected District 2 council member. In testimony whereof, I have hereunto signed my name and caused the seal of the city to be affixed at the city of Duncanville this 20th day of May, 2014. And we're missing the seal, so maybe you can take care of that for him. We'll get that taken care of.
Thank you very much.
And this is for you too.
Okay, thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council.
Let me introduce the agenda item
first.
Agenda item 21, conduct a public hearing to receive input concerning potential projects for the Community Development Block Grant Program for year 2014. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Hodge. Thank you, Council. I wanted to update the Council and the Mayor on our 2014 CDBG program and bring you up to date. Up to this point, the county has held public hearings. They held their hearing on the 29th. We did attend that hearing, and they've been receiving public input through phone calls and internet. Can you hear me better now? Okay. They've been also receiving public input through phone calls, and they have a website dedicated to that. They have not received any additional input to this point. Tonight is the City of Duncanville's public hearing. We have two items on the agenda tonight. The first is a public hearing.
Excuse me, just one moment. There's a question as to whether you wanted some pictures taken with your family before they leave. We can call them back and now or never. It's the first time here. So.
They left because their picture wasn't taken, see?
Yep, ma'am.
I thought there was some family.
We thought those were your family that just left. Well, let's continue now. Thank you. You're welcome.
Okay, back to CDBG 2014. We've held public hearings with Dallas County's held a public hearing. At our last council meeting, we presented information on the program. And tonight is the city of Duncanville's public hearing. So before we start the public hearing, I wanted to give you all a brief presentation on the CDBG program, what it's all about. The Dallas County receives funding for eligible cities. Duncanville's share this year is $105,278, and the projects that we're looking at are located in areas where 51% of the families are classified as low to moderate income families. So there are a variety of projects that may be funded, but they have to meet one of three objectives. That's to eliminate blight, eliminate a community threatening condition. That would be something like your water plant got wiped out by a tornado, or benefits the low mod income people. This is a map of Duncanville based on our census data from 2000 that shows the areas of the city that are low to mod income areas. So all the projects that we'll be talking about are located in these areas. In fact, they must be located to be accepted by the county. I can leave this up here for a minute or keep going. So what we're doing tonight at our public hearing is to receive input from the public on our project selection for tonight. And just so you're aware that we're under a pretty rigorous timeline here, we have to submit our applications by this Friday at 3:30. So we need to take action tonight to meet that deadline. The next item is going to be a resolution of support, which is also required to come along with the application process. So that'll be next after our public hearing. Every year, we've been funding a portion, or using a portion of our CDBG funding for a code enforcement officer. And this officer helps our other code enforcement officer and is really there to eliminate blight in that area and to enforce code and to just bring the neighborhood up through code enforcement. Now, tonight, we have two additional candidates that we'd like to discuss with y'all. The two candidates are, one is a street reconstruction and the other is new sidewalk. Option one, or candidate one, would be street reconstruction. It's a cost of about $95,000. This is an example of what the paving looks like right now. This is where we're talking about East Fane, over to Carter, to Calder, south to Shorewood. So this is, we feel like it's a worthy project and it meets the CDBG goals, and that's project number one. Project number two, candidate number two, option two, it would be new sidewalk on Winding Trail and Oriole. Now what this does, it fills in gaps in our existing sidewalk system. So these are neighborhoods that may have sidewalk on one side of the street but not on the other, or they have gaps in existing sidewalk that we'd like to fill in. That's about a $90,000 project. In case y'all are wondering, we got our budget estimates for paving from the county, and the concrete sidewalks are based on our contract prices. Now this is Winding Trail. And you'll see sidewalk on one side of the street, but nothing on the other side of the street. There's about 1,500 feet or so of a gap there. There's also another gap on Oriole that's included in this. But this just kind of illustrates what we're talking about. So the new sidewalk would go on the other side of the street. This is a map of the project area. It starts at Sun Valley, goes up to Cavan, and then picks up back at Cavan on Summit Ridge, and then connects to existing sidewalk. And we're going on Oriole, Fair Meadows, to just north of Carr to connect to another sidewalk on each end.
Just to summarize, our three candidates, in fact, would be option one, which would be the code enforcement officer and street reconstruction. Option two for a code enforcement officer and new sidewalks. And option three for a code enforcement officer and a project which has not yet been determined. With that, I'll open it up to questions or comments before we start our public hearing.
I do have a question and a suggestion, not necessarily
yes,
on
ma'am.
The project for this year.
Mm-hmm.
I thank for putting the packet together. This is actually the first time I've seen the application and the process. And the application actually allows these funds to be used for the ADA accommodations. But yet I have never seen that in any of our information. All we have ever been told is the blight and the low-income areas. And while I don't have any ADA projects in mind at this time, it might be appreciate having that added on here so that if something does come up, we're at least aware that it can be used for that in the future.
It can be used for that. ADA projects are very difficult to perform. And one of the problems is with ADA is once you touch it, you must fix it. So it's hard to define a stopping place. Although I'm willing to look at that, I would ask that we look at that for maybe next year for a specific area or a building, and you know, come up with a good plan that we talk to a registered accessibility specialist and get some input from. I don't think we have time to do that in 3 days.
No, as I said, I don't have any plans, and I'm not
right.
saying that in the future there would be, but I think if the information's there and the ability is there that at some point we may want to use it, and mm-hmm. if you don't know about it, you won't be able to do it. So.
Well, this is something I would encourage you guys all year long to,
yeah,
you know, communicate with the city manager and or public works director or even myself. And if you have ideas, it's never too early for us to start looking at them. In fact, the sooner the better, because some of these, like an ADA project, would be very complicated, and we'd have to really define the scope very well to set the budget correctly.
Couldn't just like additional parking spaces be considered an ADA project?
It could be if it met one of the three objectives. They have to benefit a group of low to mod people, eliminate blight, or you know, some type of community threatening. So I would say generally yes, but we'd have to be more specific and really look at a particular project and get the county's input before I could answer for sure yes or no that would qualify.
Okay. Well, the way I read this the ADA projects wouldn't have to be in the low-income areas. It could be anywhere in the city. They said it would be considered of a national objective, which apparently mm-hmm. would qualify. So.
Yeah.
All right. Councilman Smith.
Hey, Mr. Bradley, on this, we've got options 1, 2, and 3. If we do the sidewalk improvements, for example, out of option 2, is that going to be concrete sidewalks or is it going to be asphalt?
It'll be a 4-foot concrete sidewalk back a curb from end point to end point to
okay.
fill in that gap.
Okay.
It would be the same as the sidewalk that's out there.
Okay.
I think we're going to go ahead and open the public hearing then. I don't have any other lights.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Do we have anyone wishing to speak in this public hearing? You can come forward, give your name and address, please.
Hello, John Walkers, 303 Tanglewood. I'd like to speak to this. It may not be that there's anything we can do this week in the course of 3 days, but I'd like to, in light of what the mayor said, I remember talking to one of my neighbors about the issue in District 2, who had expressed concerns about their street not being walkable and bikeable. I thought it was eminently walkable, but if you had a wheelchair, The curb cuts at the various driveways would be very difficult to navigate. Now, my street isn't that way, and in fact, many of the districts, I think District 1 has got a lot of, the streets are well ADA compliant, even not just at the corners, but, you know, it just depends on where you are in the city. So I really hadn't given a lot of thought to that issue of how difficult it would be to navigate one of our sidewalks with a wheelchair. Now, I don't think a lot of people are trying to do that, and a lot of people in wheelchairs get around in motorized vehicles. I don't know that how much demand there is for people to stroll through their neighborhood on a wheelchair on the sidewalk. However, one of my neighbors did express concerns about that. And so that, in my mind, would be an ADA compliance issue, and I'm not unconcerned about the situation that our residents have who are trying to get around town and they can't navigate the sidewalks, and you can't very well safely do that in the street. So dealing with the curb cut issues, not at the curb cuts, but rather at some of the driveways, might be something. I don't know if it would be a modest in cost, but there are a few streets like Horn Street in District 2 that would fit into that category that we might want to have a look at for next year. And like I said, we're not unconcerned about that. It isn't a problem for me, but for those of my neighbors that it is a problem, I'm not unconcerned. So thank you.
Wesley Jameson, 1214 Lady Lane. I think we need to follow past precedent with the code enforcement officer. I think no matter which other way the money is spent left over from that piece, we have what, one code enforcement officer in the city now, and this has been utilized in years past as a method for code enforcement in the areas of the city that are designated for this block grant. So I would like to see whatever else is done that the code enforcement officer be an integral part of the proposal.
Seeing no one, I entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. Would you? Oh.
I apologize. Tanny Brantley, Project Duncanville, West Center Street, 217 West Center Street. I was wondering if a community garden would be able to be filed under a grant for this? A community garden? If we're.
We'd have to ask the county.
Okay.
There's a possibility.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now, a motion and a second. Would you please vote? Motion carries 6-0. Agenda item 22, consider action to approve a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, approving submittal of for year 2014 CDBG grant project activity applications for CDBG grant funds with Dallas County, authorizing the interim city manager to execute all paperwork and project implementation agreements and providing an effective date.
Mayor, I'd like to make a motion that we consider option 2.
All right, we have a motion to consider option 2. Is there a second on that? Councilman Smith?
You have these listed here, options 1, 2, 3.
Yes, sir.
1, 2, and 3. Are those in the order that you think?
No.
You don't have them in any particular order?
No. I was just got the quote for the streets first.
You're trying to do the streets first?
I got the quote back first for the streets,
okay.
So that was number one. Was not in order of preference.
I will second her motion.
Okay, I have a motion second then. Did you want to talk as well? Your light's on?
No, I just wanted
okay.
to make sure I didn't get
Mayor Pro Tem Cooks.
So, I'm sorry. So we're asking to choose one, or are we have an opportunity to choose 1, 2, or 3 at any point? So I guess that's what I was looking. The city recommendation, what are you recommending one over the other?
Well, what we have on this item is an options resolution. We have the council's option to choose option one, option two, or an undetermined option. So we suggest option one or two, but any viable project would suffice for option three. We'd have to come up with cost estimates and, you know, scope and get with the county quickly, but it's not out of the realm. But we think we have two good projects, and, you know, I think they're both worthy of your consideration.
But the deadline is...
The deadline's the 23rd, so the resolution you have tonight would be to authorize your approval to submit an application for either option one, two, or a third option.
So you don't need any additional time to get additional information, and you're pretty comfortable
with it? We don't have additional time. We have until Friday, 3:30.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Mayor.
Councilwoman Jameson.
The reason why I suggested the second one with the sidewalks is that I'm familiar with, and I've had phone calls about all the children that walk to school to Fair Meadows. There's a lot of walkers, and they're concerned about the safety of the area that they have to walk and not having sidewalks. And
when I was out there with my measuring wheel, I had a chance to talk to a few people, and of course they want to know what you're doing. And when I told them, we're
they need some sidewalks.
Yes. So I got, you know, three different people that were happy about it.
Yeah, they're I would say the majority of the children
100%
walk.
That I saw. You know, I try to engage people and just tell them what I'm doing, and they were all in support.
Thank you.
Councilman Boyd.
Yeah, I second the motion because somewhat of the same reason. I think it serves and I understand the ADA side of that too. But I think the children are more users of the sidewalk than the elderly people are. My question would be, and it's just a question, is it we can't have a little of both? I mean, we can't find the most critical disconnected sidewalk so they at least have one on every side, at least on one side of the street. I mean, I'm not trying to
just filling one or the other of those gaps would eat up our leftover chunk of our $105,000. We're funding the remainder of the project out of our street fund.
Then I'll stick with
fund.
The children then.
So we,
okay.
We don't have a lot of money. $105,000 in construction dollars is not a big amount of money.
Councilman Smith.
I think particularly on North Fair Meadows, Oreo, those kids going home, that was my concern. So I'll be voting for it.
All right, I have no other lights. I have a motion and a second for option number two. Would you please vote? Motion carries 6-0. Agenda item 23. Consider approval of a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville declaring that the ethics complaint dated January 9th, 2014, filed by Councilmember at-large Patrick Harvey, did not accuse Mayor Deborah Hodge of sexual harassment, and that any characterization that said complaint alleges such conduct is erroneous and false.
Mayor, I'd like to move to make a motion to postpone this. Since Councilman Harvey is not here tonight, he did make us aware that he was not going to be here tonight. I'd like to make a motion that we postpone this to our next agenda item. Our next meeting, yes.
I'll second it, so it's done.
Really want to put this off any longer. I mean, if he wants to put it back on and say something next week. We have a motion and a second to pull the agenda item. Would you please vote? Motion carries 4-2. Agenda item 24. The city will, remind again that the reception was canceled, but the agenda item is take any necessary appropriate action on closed executive session matters, and There was no action to be taken tonight, so we are adjourned.